notebook. You pocket the worn brown leather journal. Inland Empire says, a trusted friend left behind. We should read this immediately, Kim says. Like, right now. Okay. I will. You found Ruby's journal. Read it. Let me restart the recording. A little power went out on my computer last episode, so I want to make sure everything's locked in. Interact. A well-loved journal with a brown leather cover and the brand name Schneller embossed on the back. It seems to have served as a loyal friend to a lonely traveler. A thick journal. The cover is worn, like someone used to carry it around in their back pocket. The cover is made of full-grain leather. The lower left corner on the back cover sports an embossed brand name, Schneller. Encyclopedia says, Schneller is a stationery brand from Gottwald, beloved among architects and engineers. Conceptualization says, she's got good taste and must have taken whatever she recorded here seriously. I have one skill point. I'm going to save it. Oh, wait. Unwind the strap. The journal falls open. About two-thirds of its ruled pages have been filled. Study the handwriting. The large cursive of someone who writes quickly and confidently. Interfacing says, perhaps too confidently, many phrases and even paragraphs that have been crossed out with tiny corrections scrawled above and in the margins. So she's like a perfectionist or something. Flip through the pages. It's a mix of logistical notes, diagrams, and personal reflections, all dated. Kim says, it's good she left in a hurry. We could learn a lot from this. Logistics, diagrams, personal. Far back do they go? How far back do the entries go? The first entry is from August 2nd of last year. It reads simply, I know my position is precarious. All I can do is make myself as useful as I can while looking for a way out. Remember, in parentheses, no one is indispensable. What kinds of logistics? Hard to tell exactly. It's mostly noted down in code. Looks like contact information, quantities, directions. Kim says, there could be useful information about the local operations in those notes. We have a junior sergeant at my station who's good with codes. I can give this to her after we finish this. What are the diagrams of? Esoteric radio technology. The most recent ones probably pertain to the latitude compressor. Sketches, calculations of distance and density. You make out a familiar spiral shape. Anything about La Putra Madre? That name isn't mentioned, as far as you can tell. Logic says, small wonder. Would you talk about La Putra Madre in your journal? You do see an M, though. M is mentioned on March 9th and March 15th. Read the entry from March 9th first. This March 9th was... what's the first entry? August 2nd of last year. Great. M's peon is coming to town, no doubt to investigate the lynching, but also, I feel it in my gut, to finally put a bullet in my head while I'm napping in my lorry or on a smoke break, while I won't stick around just to twist my own neck by constantly looking over my shoulder. Then again, isn't that what I've been doing ever since I got the call? Inland Empire says, were you supposed to find her? Even apart from the investigation, then? On M's request? No, you wouldn't do something like this. This must be a mistake. Am I sure this is a mistake? Look at me. Whatever you may look like, you don't feel like a hired assassin. Read the entry from March 12th. Been holed up here for 3 days now. I'm used to being alone and all, but I don't know when I'll be able to leave or if I'll be ratted out. They will rat me out, of course. I've made it a point to believe in the best in people, the boys, for example, but experience tells me. Did M feel truly betrayed by me? I was feeling threatened. He'd have to know if he threatened people. They take measures to protect themselves. Even I know that. Economic measures, first of all. Gotta make a living, right? I could still hear his voice in the receiver. Taste the plastic. M. I don't know who M would be. The entry ends abruptly. Anything personal? Short, wry observations of people and places, probably a way to pass the time on the road. Also, what appear to be attempts to sort through some difficult decisions. There are a few passages with many questions in them. Authority says, staff issues, always tough on the leadership. You smell traces of betrayal. What did she write the day Lely died? Nothing on March 4th. March 5th, though. Well, that's bound to come back and bite me in the ass. I'm bad at this. Loyal to a fault, except... But that's another matter entirely. Logic says, you have no idea what she means. These are personal notes. Don't expect to understand all of it. Well, I was seeing what she did for Classier. That's bound to come back and bite her in the ass. I don't know what the except is about, though. Look at the cover again. What's the most recent entry? The most recent entry is from today. It reads... Task complete. Even when I leave here, if I leave her alive, what's my next move? Staging a lynching is a crime, even if I'm not accused of murder on top of that. Forever on the run? Not really an idea of the open road. Man, I was really looking forward to winning. The lieutenant taps on the page. It looks like she might have been framed? Esprit de Corps says, that would be a first, or fourth. But who's counting, he thinks. Very rarely does anyone actually get framed. If she didn't do it, then maybe it's good that we didn't catch her? I wouldn't go so far as to say that. We have other reasons to arrest her. He frowns. Besides, I'm not sure her life as a fugitive is going to be much better than with us, especially if she has problems with the Madre. Kim, am I really La Puta Madre agent? He looks you straight in the eye for a moment, then sighs. No, I don't think you are. Ask someone in your precinct if you want to be sure. Drama says he truly does not believe you are. Perhaps he shouldn't be so trusting. Volition says his trust is well placed. You aren't. You can feel it. Then who do you think killed the Merc? Could have been Titus. Then again, he pauses to think. But no one heard the shot. Maybe there's a Hardie Boy we've yet to meet who acted as his accomplice? Either way, we need to keep an eye on him. One thing is for certain. We have business back in the Whirling and Rags. Questions to ask? We should get to it. Okay, return to the Whirling and Rags. After the whole instigator debacle, someone there has something to answer to. And are you La Puta Madre's peon? Ruby said you were a notoriously corrupt cop. The peon. That's why she was scared of you. When you get the chance, call your station to find out more, if you dare. Alright, so we don't have much to do. Call the station. And, the Whirling and Rags. We still have to check that island for bullet traces. Not sure how we get over there. And look, try to find a working firearm. And somehow run into the Dolores Day herself. And this one we're not doing. And I'm not internalizing that thought. Speaking of which... I have 1 point. Oh, I'm close to leveling up. If I get another point... I'll put in another... I'll forget one of these to... get another thought in. I still want to leave us with no points. So I guess now we're just running back. I'm glad we destroyed that thing. Oh, this is a dead end. So here I thought it was like the point of no return for like we weren't going to go back after this. I thought the end was near. Well, it might still be near. Oh, I made it through there without the flashlight. Hope I didn't miss anything. I see no reason to talk to these people. I have to go around that way. Okay. Music off. Wait. Hand-eye coordination says, what you have isn't enough. You'll need more firepower. A ranged weapon. Your Kyalsen KR plus 2 multi-tool looks impressive, shining in the cold spring light, but what can it do against military-grade weaponry? What am I supposed to do? Be prepared. Make sure you have your pepper box in your hand, as Inland Empire says. Oh, it says stop, just up ahead. Danger, I missed that. Okay, I guess pepper box is gun. Interfacing says, your fingers instinctively, reflexively, actually, reach for the Villiers 9mm pistol in your pocket. I'm not sure I feel ready for what lies ahead. The lieutenant frowns. Then you'd better get ready, he says. Then quickly adds, whatever happens, I've got your back. Okay. Gun. Is it under tools? Yes. Pepper box. That's what it is. Holding the gun feels natural and satisfying. It's like an extension of your arm, the polished wooden handle almost fusing into your palm. I think my hand recognizes it. It reminds you of the day you first held it, with fear and respect, hoping you don't have to use it in vain. The sun was out in Jamrock. It was so long ago. This is your gun. Now, if only we could find your personality. Wonderful. Let's get a little health back. Put in a save. People are going to attack us. Courtenier?
I'm all out of shit to give, loincloth. Welcome to the fucking reckoning.
There's a feverish gleam in his eyes. Loincloth. Who are these people? These are the Hardie Boys. Six of them? Unless there's another one covered by his portrait there. See, what's her name is back.
Put your goddamn gun down. People are gonna get hurt. We need to talk this through, all right?
Titus remains calm.
Shut up! You're not gonna talk yourself out of this, loincloth shit fuck!
Perception sight says, this is the mercenary at the gates. His chest rises and falls under the ceramic breastplate. His fingers reach for the butt of his sidearm. Kim, what's going on here?
Shh.
The lieutenant raises his left hand.
This is a misunderstanding. Nothing irreversible has happened yet. You can just return to your unit and forget all about this.
The Kipt is merciful, willing to spare us if we just forget about our murdered and humiliated commander. I think we should just kill everyone, Courtney.
Her tone is frighteningly emotionless. So, DePaul and Courtenair. Courty for short.
You all drunk. Come to your senses. You won't gun down 7 people in the middle of the street. This isn't a frontier town. Or a jungle outpost.
So there is 7 people, I see. Window 4, 5, 6. Oh, there's someone standing here behind the portrait. I can see the feet. She sounds very sure of herself, Elizabeth.
Easy, Lizzie. Let me handle it. I know guys like this. I'm sure we can come to a peaceful agreement. Ain't that right, fella?
His voice is almost gentle. Authority says he is facing overwhelmingly superior firepower, and he knows it.
Peaceful!
Who's this? Rud Hoenkloen? Is there somebody else on this side? Oh, this is this guy, maybe? Yeah, the hat. He's standing there. I didn't even see him. It sounds like the armored figure is weeping.
Nest in your abdominal cavity, like a little wild mouse!
The masked man's words are barely intelligible, but you can hear them.
Fuck, there's the third one. How did we miss something like this?
The lieutenant points to the helmeted figure. Yeah, no, I'm not so... I don't feel so bad that I missed it. Head-eye coordination says, this third one, he is the most dangerous of them all, heavily armed. Empathy says the lieutenant is genuinely worried for his life. You should consult him before getting in there. What do we do?
My plan is not to get killed, but we have to intervene.
He puts his hand on his shoulder. The big one is the mercenary at the gates.
If this turns into a firefight, we should take him out first.
He nods. But it's the other guy who has the gun. He's the more dangerous one. Logic says a sound strategy. He's the leader. We're out of time. This is...
The mercenary tribunal.
The lieutenant nods. Stop. This is the police. Oh, boy.
Get lost, comedian. You cops had your chance. Now it's fucking time for some justice.
He licks his lips, waving his gun at the crowd. Losing his balance for a moment, he staggers backward. Well, this is our chance, then. Empathy says, I think he calmed down a bit. That's calm down?
Big fuck!
Is the only word you can make out. It doesn't sound calm. I can see you're drunk.
Oh yeah, welcome to the fucking party. You're probably gonna get killed too. I don't give a shit if you're cops.
He looks around.
No one is going to kill anyone. Let's just put the guns down and talk like civilized human beings.
Rhetoric says she doesn't seem to understand the severity of the situation. With a wordless gurgle, the killer loads his long rifle. The leader gives a small nod to the helmeted man. Suddenly the grip of your sidearm feels comforting and warm in your hand. Feels like it's saying, do it. Hand-eye coordination says, shoot him in the mouth. Shoot him before he shoots you. Rhetoric says, no, wait. It's good you have that gun. It really is. Just soften him up first. Present an argument. Composure says, I'm barely keeping you together here. This is it, the big one. If you talk to him, he will rattle you, not the other way around. Okay, so hand-eye coordination says shoot him. Rhetoric says not to. Composure says to shoot him. Or not to talk to him in any case, which would be shooting him. Empathy says peace, always peace. It has worked thus far. Start with the first idea you have, then move down from that, please. Think of an argument? I have a good chance of that. Talk about the hangman. We have a low chance for this. Shoot Courtenaire. Since I there's a good chance I'll fail at that. Let's not try to shoot him. If I choose one of these, am I just... Will one of these go forward into being shot, in other words? Who is that? Pointing to the man. I didn't know you had a third guy. Rud? Rud is the killer. The armored woman smiles a vicious smile. Rud the killer Hoenkloen. He doesn't talk much. All of you bleep inside out. What was that, Rud? Rip you open. Conceptualization says perhaps it's for the best, him not talking too much. The killer? The gunner. Cortinero gestures toward himself. The raidist, he nods toward the woman, the killer. He points to the figure clad entirely in ceramic plate. What do you think he does? He kills? Smart loincloth. He stares at you with his watery eyes. He screws natives up, soldier of apocalypse style. Volition says, easy, easy now. You're all drunk. Look at yourselves. Yes, so what? I'm drunk too. Let's dance. Al Ghul is a trick. Your judgment is impaired. You'll regret this. Nah. He wipes the sweat from his brow. I'm clear as day. Government-ordained super soldier. Enough already. What is this? The woman's voice is furious. We didn't come to chit-chat. Interrupt me again and I'll execute you on the spot, Lance Corporal. The outburst is accompanied by yellowish saliva around his mouth. The Wild Pines rep does not approve of this. You think I care what the company thinks? He laughs. It's hollow laughter. Wild Pines is not going to forgive you for massacring a bunch of innocent people. He stares at you with bloodshot eyes, a bull ready to charge. He's not listening, but looking for an opening. She's going to be mad when she hears about this. She's gone, the shout echoes back from the whirling windows. She sailed off. You're alone. Stay cool. Don't do anything stupid, Titus shouts to his men in the background. The company, bleep, is gone. Lily's gone. Heloise's still doing this. Bleep, hole. He looks around, tired suddenly, sad even. Shanky says, guys, the little guy breaks formation. I just get in the way. I don't even have a gun. As he runs to the yard, Titus turns to his men. Hold your ground. Any more of you run, I'll shoot you myself. We're doing this together. They're huddled close in a formation. Steel. The rest will stay, even if it means dying here with him. Listen, they didn't do it. Yeah? Who did then? It was me. I think it was Clashier. The bird? He puts his hand on the gun. You telling me a bird killed our colonel? Well, then it wasn't her. She was the only person in the room when he died, upstairs. You think I'm stupid? There's a dangerous gleam in his eye. What if I just shot one of your pals here right now, huh? He points the gun at Elizabeth. How about the Kipt? Go ahead. Tell me about some room again. Listen, please. She raises both hands. This cop and this drumhead court-martial won't decide who... Okay, logic. Think. Why doesn't he believe me? Oh, God. Your mind grinds to a halt. All you can see is a revolver in the man's armored hand, swaying, pointed at her. You move your mouth like a fish, gasping for air. No, she wasn't even there. Oh, boy. He pulls the trigger. A plume of smoke erupts from the muzzle. Perception hearing says, the shot rings in your ears, a low tinny ring. Then the Hardie Boys yell something. The woman grabs her left side. She's down. Her white shirt soaks a blood red around her abdomen. She gasps for air, repeating, I'm okay. I'm okay. She's not, Endurin says. She's bleeding out. If she doesn't get help in 10 minutes, she'll die. Screw this. Eugene starts pulling something out from his pocket. Gene, the big man raises his head. Tend to Lizzie, now. All right, talk about the hangman, think of an argument. Got Gardner shot. We're still calling her the Gardner. Minus one for that, and minus one there. Gardner is dying. Well, this is better. Think of an argument. All right, here we go, Rhetoric says. This is an illegal tribunal. Krennel would never sanction this. Who's the commanding officer? Take your pick. Reaction speed says, you only have time for one argument. Choose wisely. Who's in charge of your unit after the death of your colonel? Krennel does not give you a right to conduct a tribunal. Yeah, this one. Who's in charge of a unit after the death of your colonel? Okay. Colonel does not give you the right to conduct a tribunal. Pops, he says, looking at your saggy sideburns. And no sideburns, I shave those off. They seem to calm him down for a second. You have no idea about the rights Colonel extends to us. Okay, what rights are those then? If I screw and kill you, hang you by that street light, he points to it, by your bleep pipes, then that's called a necessary display of force. No one's going to give a crap about dead loincloths, he snorts. That's reality. Redrick says, okay, it's not much, but he's thinking about something else, and his hand is off his gun. This did something. Physical instrument says, now, fire, screw them up, do it. The muscles on your back tense up. Better chance, but I have a better chance for this. Talk about the hangman. Oh, of course. Suggestion says, nothing bad will happen. Talk about his dead friend. He seems stable enough to take it. Ugh. Am I sure? He's already shot one person. Ever better. It will further destabilize him, costing time and maybe even lives. Okay, which means you're wrong because we failed. That's a bad roll. I didn't see the roll. It must have been bad. So maybe we can scroll back and see the roll. I feel like I got to know your dead friend during our investigation. You don't talk to me about my brother, Loincloth. He squeezes the words out from between clamped lips, his hand on the pistol. Suggestion says, okay, yes, immediate action, immediate failure. Things are worse now. He's observing your every motion carefully. Plus one, forgot him to talk. Okay, where is Clashé? She can explain this. Who the hell is that? Clashé? The woman upstairs? Kim says, where is she? Gart says, she left. The manager calls down from the balcony. Oh, that's who's standing there. Composure says, unarmed, hunched, but keeping it together. Gart, what the hell are you doing here? What am I doing? My establishment is under fire. He points to the armored figures. You know how much windows cost? Well, I broke one of them, so... What do you mean she left? She left. Her room is cleaned out, right before these jerks showed up. I should have said something other than jerks, but... We should have arrested her, the lieutenant whispers, his eyes still on the armed mercenaries. But we didn't know. We didn't have enough evidence yet. Or any evidence. We still don't have any. Except in this, I guess there's something in that journal that we haven't seen. Empathy says you can feel how upset he is with himself. Just for a second. Then the fear takes over and he's back in the moment. Hey, Bushman! The veins on the man's neck expands and he yells. Your little bleep isn't going to help you out of this one. Alright, I'm not going to stand there and just hope nothing bad happens. Let's shoot Cortinaire. Success or failure? Item lost. Success! A plume of smoke and fire erupts from the gun, and your hand goes numb from the explosion. Look through the smoke rising from the barrel. The smoke drifts west with the wind. You hear the plaza erupt in violence, slow, like a waterfall in reverse. Well, they didn't have a chance to shoot this guy. So now he's gonna shoot. And her. Look at Cortinaire. There's a hole in his cheek. Blood gushes out as he stumbles backward, eyes fill with rage and disbelief, gurgling, muttering something unintelligible. Now I think the lady, might back down. Because that's the leader, he's gone, losing morale, that kind of stuff. But this guy, there's something seriously wrong with him. Rud? It said Rud something. To your right, the killer raises his rifle and takes aim at you. His moves are steady, but the long barrel of his rifle sways slowly. Kim, where's Kim? From the corner of your eye, you see the lieutenant raise his pistol and aim it at Rud. Visual calculus says he's trying to find a straight line of sight before the rifleman can take you out. In the background, the leader staggers. Blink, think. You stare down the barrel of the gun. You see Rud's mask behind it, his eye in the slit of the helmet, like a camera lens focusing on you. This kind of looks like death. Kind of looks like a building almost. Right? With windows. Like a courtyard here. Hand-eye coordination says 0.4 seconds remain. There are six little black dots in the tip of the barrel, like a honeycomb. This is a knock cannon. It shoots six rounds in one pull of the trigger. Conceptualization says absolute destruction. Endurance says, is there anything? Anything we could use to protect this frail body? That gun will tear us to pieces. Savoir-Fair says, a full suit of armor. Can't be too agile. You can shift direction faster than he can. Plus one for your faster. Dodge the shot. Damn it. End. Damage health 2. The shot rings and you stumble. Something violently tugs at your shoulder, pushing you backwards with incredible force. Alright, go, Kim. A volcano of burning pain erupts from your left shoulder. Pain threshold says the pain flows over your entire body like an awful shock. A grim knowing rises from within. Half of your body must be gone. Would this help? Nothing happened? It's not working. The lieutenant aims, face pale. Without trembling, he quietly utters, God, please. Visual calculus says he's aiming for the eye slot in Rood's helmet, an extremely difficult shot. Then, two shots ring at once. And you hear a scream, but you're too hurt to see who got hit. Kim, did he hit the rifleman? Blood gushes from the helmet's eye sockets as Rood staggers back, disoriented. The sounds coming from his helmet are not human. Hand-eye coordination says, an unbelievable shot from the lieutenant. And I guess, and she shot Kim, who screamed. Glenn! Dying in a puddle of blood behind you, his mangled torso has two gunshot wounds. Blood gushes out of them like red geysers. Inland Empire says, oh God, watch out! You see two crazed eyes stare at you through all the smoke and the panic. With blood gushing from his face, the man raises his pistol at you. Oh, I got my stuff back. Now it happened. Then he squeezes the trigger. Look him in the eye. The look of vengeance, framed in blood, lips shaking. This is the last thing he'll do on Earth, but he will do it. He is your end. Half-Life says, here it comes. Death. Very low, okay. Evade the shot. Yep. Reaction speed says, you can't. There is no time. Something inside your pelvis explodes. Your entire lower body is on fire, and your legs can't support you. You fall down like a rag doll. Pain threshold says, the pain is too immense to scream. It pushes the air out of your lungs. Everything goes dark, a distant blur as you recede into it. Listen, through the darkness and the pain. The Hardie Boys are screaming, fighting, dying. Someone jumps over you. Nearby gunfire shatters glass. Gart yells, stop! Titus says, the cop! Protect the cop! He's down! Touch your lower body. Feel slick and warm with blood. The pain is too strong to know what has happened here. Even clutching to your consciousness takes everything you got. What parts of me are missing? Most of what's down there. Oh, God. It's all gone, reaction speed says. Open your eyes now. You have to see what's happening. Inland Empire says, no, no, it's just a fear. Even if... who cares? No one wants you anyway. What do I see? Perception sight says nothing. A persisting darkness. Dancing lights of pain. Distant shadows cast by them like a hellish play. Out of it, a silhouette appears, crouching over you. You hear a familiar voice filled with urgency and fear. You're bleeding out! I don't know why I would say that. It's so dark. I can't see anything. Stay with me! The lieutenant pushes down on your wound hard. You hear me? Stay awake. Look at me. But you can't. It's so hard. Your eyelids grow heavy, and the sounds ever more distant, and a cold comes over you. Kim, too, is somewhere far away, almost gone, when suddenly you sense something behind him. A slender white shadow towering. Someone stands there, raising her pistol at him. The lieutenant does not see it. He's pushing down on your wound with both hands. Authority. Very high. +1 for Lieutenant trusts you, and +2 for Kim truly trusts you. No, Kim!